U.S. Senator presidential candidate Ted Cruz joins me live on the line. Good morning. How are you today?
Good morning, Charlie. I'm doing terrific. How are you?
I appreciate it. Well, do you think that today's election will be a turning point in this presidential campaign?
Well, I certainly hope so, and I think it has every potential to be. All of the signs are encouraging. You know, we've had now for 2 weeks a steady stream of victories against Donald Trump. It started 2 weeks ago in Utah, where we won 69% of the popular vote and got all 40 of the delegates out of Utah. It then continued just a few days ago in Colorado, where two congressional districts voted and elected their delegates. There were six delegates at state, and we won all six. We went 6-for-6. It then continued 2 days ago in North Dakota, where they had their convention and elected their delegates. And of the delegates who have declared, 18 are with us, and only one was with Donald Trump. 18-1 is a ratio I'm happy to take any day. And then tonight in Wisconsin, I think the entire country is looking to Wisconsin. Wisconsin has a national platform and megaphone. And if we end up with a win tonight, it is going to have national repercussions, not just for the 42 delegates at stake here in Wisconsin, but I believe it is going to powerfully impact the states to come, and I'm hopeful and optimistic with the energy and momentum we're seeing.
Now, I've said this before, that the only way that you're going to lose tonight is if conservatives continue to divide their votes, and you have expressed some frustration with John Kasich's persistence in this race. Do you want him to drop out?
Well, I think any candidate that doesn't have a path to winning, that's the time when you should suspend your campaign. And at this point, Kasich has been mathematically eliminated. He needs more than 100% of the delegates to be the nominee. That's obviously impossible. You can't get more than 100%. And he's lost 30 states in a row. The only state he's prevailed in is his home state. And so John Kasich is a good and honorable man. But he doesn't have a path to win. And at this point, well, Mitt Romney put it very well 2 weeks ago when Mitt Romney said a vote for John Kasich is a vote for Donald Trump, that it simply divides the vote. And if you don't want to see Donald Trump as the nominee, and if Donald is our nominee, it elects Hillary. It hands the general election to Hillary. Hillary beats Donald Trump by double digits. Hillary beats the Trump by double digits here in Wisconsin and across the country, whereas I beat Hillary Clinton. And so if you don't want to see Donald Trump as the nominee, if you don't want to see Hillary Clinton as the president, then I ask you to please come out today and stand with us. I ask for your vote, because if we stand united, we're going to win here in Wisconsin, and a win here in Wisconsin will have a powerful effect nationwide, continuing to unite Republicans behind our campaign to win this nomination, and then to win the general election and beat Hillary and change the direction we're on, bring jobs back to America, protect our rights, and keep us safe.
Senator Cruz, now I did just ask you two horse race questions. I'm really struck by the watching 24/7 cable coverage, how little attention there is to the actual issues and substance.
Yep.
And I know that you and some of the other candidates have been very frustrated about that. So I wanted to spend a couple of minutes. There really is a sense, when you think about what this campaign is about, there's kind of a sense out there that America's best days are past, that somehow that American dream is slipping away from average Americans. How does a Ted Cruz presidency turn that around?
Well, Charlie, you're exactly right. And you know, today, for the first time in the history of our country, a majority of Americans, 65%, believe that our kids will have a worse life than we did. That is a horrifying reality, that so many people believe that, and it is a manifestation of just how great a failure the Obama-Clinton economy has been. I am convinced, though, that this doesn't have to be the case, that we can turn this around. And the way we do so is by getting back to the principles that built America in the first place. You know, the great thing about eternal truth, they're always true. This country was built on small businesses, on job creation, on economic opportunity, on people being able to come with nothing and achieve anything. You know, in 1957, my father fled Cuba with nothing, with $100 in his underwear, and washed dishes making 50 cents an hour, but was able to pay his way through school and to start a business. Today, my dad's a pastor. You know, that has been the journey of America. So how do we do it here? If I'm elected president, my top three priorities are jobs, freedom, and security. Let's start with jobs. My number one priority, both in the Senate and as president, will be bringing jobs back to America, raising wages, and expanding economic opportunity. And the way we do that is by getting the boot of the federal government off the back of the necks of small businesses. We do that through lessening taxes and regulation. If I'm elected president, we'll repeal every word of Obamacare. We'll pass a simple flat tax that every American can fill out our taxes on a postcard. We'll abolish the IRS. We'll rein in the EPA and the federal regulators that are killing small businesses. And we'll stop amnesty and end sanctuary cities. And the effect of all of that is we're going to see millions upon millions of high-paying jobs coming back to America, coming back from Mexico, coming back from China. We're going to see manufacturing coming back to the state of Wisconsin. We're going to see wages rising all over this country. And we're going to see young people coming out of school once again with job offers, with opportunities, with a brighter future. That's what this election's all about.
Where does education fit into this? You mentioned this. What is the role? Because we have a lot of employers, say here in Wisconsin, I'm sure you've spoken to this, that we have the jobs, but we don't have people who have the skills. We don't have people who want to, you know, we can't match up, you know, the educational background with the schools. Do we need to change the way that we train workers and educate workers and prepare them for this new economy?
Well, there's no doubt, Charlie, that education is the gateway to opportunity in this country. You know, in my family, I mentioned my dad when he fled Cuba. He was able to attend the University of Texas, and that education enabled him to build a career and achieve success in this country. My mother, likewise, was Irish and Italian, grew up in Wilmington, Delaware, in a working-class family. She became the first in her family ever to go to college, and she went to Rice University, graduated in 1956 with a degree in math, and became a computer programmer back in the 1950s, really at the dawn of the computer age. And education is so fundamental. I think we need to do a lot in terms of education.
Well, Bernie Sanders, of course, is promising, you know, free college, free education. Is that the way to go, simply to make college free?
You know, it's not, and it's one of the things the Democrats and the socialists love to do is promise free stuff. But I'll tell you this, the simplest principle of economics is Tomstoffel. There ain't no such thing as a free lunch. Everything that government gives you, it has to take from you in the form of taxes or debt. And giving free college to everyone would result in even more taxes, even more burdens on small businesses, which would mean, fine, you get free college, you come out of college, you can't get a job because the cost of paying for all of it has driven the small businesses out of existence. You know, right now, for the first time since they've started recording the data, more small businesses, more businesses are dying than are being formed. If you're a young person, you don't need free stuff. You need to be able to get a job. Mm-hmm. And if you can get a job, if you can learn skills, if you can provide for yourself, that's what gives you a brighter future. And we've seen 7 years of taxes and regulations and the stagnation. Look at how many young people are still sleeping in their parents' basements.
Well, speaking of jobs and wages, though, your reaction, California becoming the latest entity to raise the minimum wage to $15. Democrats seem all in on that. What do you think about a $15 minimum wage?
Well, listen, everyone would like to see wages going up. It's a central part of my campaign. But when government mandates it, you know, every time you raise the minimum wage, people lose their jobs. And the people who lose their jobs are low-income workers. It tends to be low-income, often teenagers, often African-Americans or Hispanic teenagers. You know, think about it from the context of my dad back when he was washing dishes. It was 1957. Now, why did he get that job? He got that job because he couldn't speak English. And you didn't have to speak English to wash dishes. You just had to stick a dish under hot water. He could do that even at 18, even not speaking English. Now, they paid him 50 cents an hour. If some well-meaning liberal politician had come in and jacked the minimum wage up to $2 an hour, you know what they would have done? They would have fired my dad, and they would have bought a dishwasher. That's the dynamic you see happening every day. The next time you go to a fast food restaurant or a restaurant, and you start ordering on an iPad, you're looking at the results of jacking up the minimum wage. What has happened is to survive, they fired the teenage kid that used to take your order, and they stuck an iPad in. That's the same thing as buying a dishwasher. And so I want to see wages go up for everyone, but I don't want to do it in a context that results in firing and throwing out of work the most vulnerable. And that's what Democrats don't understand, is every time they put more and more burdens on small businesses, they take away opportunity. You know, you talked about education. Mm-hmm. As president, I'll direct the Department of Education that Common Core ends immediately. Education should be at the state level. It should be at the local level. It should be parents and teachers deciding, not bureaucrats in Washington. And ideally, we should have much more school choice. We should have parents empowered to choose the best options for their kids, the best choices, because I think school choice is the civil rights issue of the 21st century.
Senator Cruz, do you think you're going to win tonight here in Wisconsin?
I hope so. I believe that we're going to win tonight. I think the signs are encouraging, but it really depends, Charlie, on your listeners, on your listeners coming out tonight, coming out today and voting, and bringing their friends. You know, I would ask every one of your listeners, I know you care about the direction of this country. You want to see jobs coming back. You want to see the Bill of Rights protected. You want to see us safe and secure from radical Islamic terrorism. I ask that you stand together, you come out and vote today, and that you also pick up the phone and you call a friend, call your sister, your son, or your coworker, and say, hey, why don't you come vote too, and stand with Ted as well. If we stand together, we're going to win, and I will say, Charlie, your leadership has made such an enormous difference. Thank you for being such a consistent and strong voice for freedom over and over and over again here in the state of Wisconsin.
Thank you so much, Senator Ted Cruz. Thanks for joining me. I appreciate it very much.
God bless.